And then they, after a series of arguments, they decided that it is a new aspect of ours which they have discovered. So I'll dwell a little bit more on this, because the discovery of this is a very good example of serendipity which is there in astronomy. And accompanied with serendipity, the plausibility arguments which astrophysicists use to sort of say that this is a new astronomical source. So it's a very good illustration, the discovery of pulsar, of both these kinds of things. So it was a serendipitous discovery. The serendipity because Justin Bell was not looking for pulsar. They were doing an interplanetary scintillation experiment which had nothing to do with pulsar. Pulsar was not known at that point of time. But she did notice that there are these small bumps, and she noticed it with three different periodicities using their 81 megahertz telescope near Cambridge in July. And since they looked like man-made signals, so she named them as Little Green Men, LGM-1, LGM-2, LGM-3. And then they started trying to understand. Now this is very much like the RSI which you will see in your H1 experiment. So you have hundreds of sources of radio emission which are periodic, which are created by us. So they had to be sure that this is not something which is coming from their instrument or from their environment around their telescope. So they used a number of consistency arguments to argue that this was a completely new astrophysical source. And those plausibility arguments were based on certain facts which they observed on their chart. And those facts are listed there. These bumps appeared, so if you observe this, you did your observation with this telescope every day for let's say 3 or 4 months, they noticed that the bumps were appearing 3 minutes 56 seconds earlier every subsequent day. That was one of the important things. Then they noted that the width of these bumps, or the full width at half maximum of these small little pulses, was of the order of milliseconds. And if they change the frequency of their telescope a little bit here and there, the time at which the bumps arrived at different frequencies were different. And the periodicity was typically around 1 second. The three different LGM-1, LGM-2, LGM-3 had three different periods, but they were of the order of 1 second. And this period did not remain same. It actually varied a little bit. And when they made an observation over an entire year, they found that there is a periodicity in the variation of the period. So these five facts is what they sought to explain by trying to make a model. So all these five facts are inconsistent with any human or man-made source of these radio bumps, because it is inconceivable that you will have bumps arriving at different radio frequencies at different times and so on. So then obviously they had to look for something outside the terrestrial origin. And the biggest clue there is this, because since it's happening every day 3 minutes 56 seconds earlier, as we sort of discussed with some of you and discussed, so this means that it is coming from the sky, because your sidereal day is shorter by exactly the same amount as these signals appearing every day. So which meant that the source has to be somewhere in the fixed background of the star. The fact that they arrived at different times at different radio frequencies meant that it has to be beyond the solar system. And the fact that it had a full width half maximum of few milliseconds meant that whatever was producing this emission, by a casualty argument, which means that the time taken for the source to produce this should be the time taken for the light to travel across the source. Okay. So if you apply that argument, the maximum dimension of that source would not be more than 300,000 meters, which is roughly the radius of the Earth. So whatever would be the star or the source producing this emission would not be larger than an Earth-sized object. The variation, yeah.
Please read the last argument.
The last argument is very simple, that any source which is producing this, producing a signal which has a typical width of the order of milliseconds, the two parts of the source, you should be able to send a light pulse across them. And how much distance the light travels in few milliseconds, 10 milliseconds, 50, 300,000 meters. Okay. Very quickly you can catch it. So that would be the damage, because if it is much more than that, then the Einstein special theory of relativity prohibits that. So this is called as an argument of causality, the cause and effect ability. From that, you could sort of derive the fact that it is an Earth-sized object which is producing this. The fact that the period varied slightly over the year and varied periodically meant that it has something to do with the Earth going around the Sun. So certainly this source had to be far beyond the solar system. So these facts, the only way you can explain is by sort of giving the arguments which I am giving. And these are the kind of plausibility arguments which are generally put forth when you discover something new. So by putting forth a model like this, you have now an idea that this source should be source beyond the solar system and should be of the order of Earth. So the next thing to do is to look for what kind of stars could produce this kind of a radiation. Okay. Now, at that point of time, there were only two stars which were so small, which were known. One was the white dwarfs. The first of the white dwarfs was discovered by William Herschel in the 17th century, called Eridani B. It's a triple star system, out of which the star B is a white dwarf. And the other white dwarf is fairly well known, and actually if you use your 12-inch, you should probably be able to just barely make it out. That is a companion to the brightest star in the sky, which is called Sirius. Sirius A is the brightest, the largest magnitude star in the sky. And just below that Sirius, this is a Hubble image of Sirius A. Just below the Sirius A, you see a tiny dot there. That tiny dot is the white dwarf. So these stars were Earth-sized stars. They were very dense stars. And in fact, before 1920s, people did not understand these stars, because these stars, given their density, should collapse. They should never remain like stars. Okay. It's only after 1920s, when quantum mechanics was proposed, that people could understand that. And Professor Subramanian Chandrasekhar developed the theory of white dwarfs to explain why these stars exist. The second type of star was a neutron star, which was proposed by Bard and Zwicky in 1932, almost 80 years since today. And he proposed it in the context of a large explosion which is seen often in the universe. And that explosion is the result of the death of a star, where a star collapses. And in the collapse of the star, you are left with a very dead core. Okay? And that dead core they proposed as a new star, which is entirely made up of neutrons, and they called it a neutron star. Okay. Mind you, no neutron stars were seen in 1930. In fact, before the radio pulsars were discovered, nobody knew how to detect neutron stars, because they would be very cold stars, they will be very small stars, so they will not emit much radiation. So as I said, both these stars were difficult to understand before quantum mechanics was proposed. And what Chandrasekhar did was he applied quantum mechanics to astrophysics. Okay? And he for the first time showed that unlike the ideal gas, which cannot provide sufficient support to keep a star as it is, okay? Because in a star, it's a continuous battle between the self-gravity of the star and the pressure of the gas. They balance each other. Okay? As long as they are balancing, the star is there. And because of this balance, the temperature at the center of the star is extremely high, which starts nuclear reactions, which is the engine of the star. In these stars, the density was so high that it was impossible for ideal gas to support the weight of the star. But if what Chandrasekhar and others showed is that you can have degenerate gases. You can have Fermi gases, where the matter exists in a degenerate state. And the pressure of the degenerate gas is much larger than the ideal gas. And that pressure can support both the white dwarfs and neutron stars. The distinction between white dwarf and neutron stars is that white dwarfs are supported by the degeneracy pressure of electron gas. The neutron stars are supported by the degeneracy pressure of the neutron gas. Okay. Some of you might have done SatMech and so on, so you might have come across fermions, bosons and so on. But others may not have done it. So we will not go into the details of that. They are saying that there are gases which are non-ideal gases. Okay. They are quantum mechanical gases and they have larger pressure, and that is what explained this. So the mystery of these stars was solved only in 1930s, and that is a good sort of example of application of quantum mechanics to astrophysics. So there are only these two possibilities there. So Huish and Joslin considered these two as likely sources. White dwarfs were seen earlier, but neutron stars were not seen earlier. And then they sort of tried to build models to explain the kind of pulses which you are seeing. So the pulsation could be because of one of these three reasons. Either the star was oscillating, so its luminosity was changing periodically, or the star was in a binary system where it was going around the binary companion and getting eclipsed every now and then, and that is what was producing a periodic sort of emission. Or the star was rotating with a beam anchored somewhere on the star, and every time that beam came towards you, you saw a bump. So these are the three different models. Okay. Now if you take both these stars, there are a total of 8 possibilities which you can have from this. So there are 8 different models. What Huish and Joslin Bell did was they one by one eliminated 7 out of the 8 possibilities, again based on plausibility arguments, which I'll not go into detail right now. But if any of you is interested, you can ask me at a later point of time. Leaving behind the one and only one model, which was that this was a new astrophysical object underlying which was a rotating neutron star with a beam, beamed emission which is anchored somewhere on the star. And this was also consistent with other facts which were known even before the pulsars were discovered. For example, supernovas, which is the sort of explosion, death explosion of a star, leaves behind a large shiny remnant. And it was not known what powers the supernova remnant. And theoreticians were trying to work out the energetics of supernova remnants. And one of the leading theoreticians of that time, Pacini, has this to say: rapidly rotating neutron stars with strong dipolar magnetic field would act as a very energetic electric generator, which could provide a source of energy for radiation from the surrounding nebula, such as Crab Nebula. Crab Nebula is a supernova remnant. Actually, it's a pulsar wind nebula. So people did not know what gives energy to this for its shiny sort of nature. You can radiates from radio to X-rays and gamma rays. So people did not know the source of energy. This was before the discovery of the pulsar was announced. Purely from theoretical arguments, Pacini argued that at the center of the Crab Nebula there should be a pulsar. And lo and behold, in 1969, 2 years later than this prediction, people discovered the Crab pulsar, which is the neutron star power. Okay. So this picture of stellar rotation or rotating neutron star had support from other observations which were not related to this discovery. And all this was published in a landmark Nature paper, discovery paper of the pulsar in 1967 by Huish, Bell, Pilkington and Scott, which was the discovery team. So I want to pause here after giving all this background to the discovery to sort of emphasize certain things which are very important in science in general and astronomy and astrophysics in particular. So in many of the new discoveries, both the things are important. Only serendipity is not important, or only scientific arguments are not important. We need to get both of them together. And for both of these to play a role, it is important to design an experiment which is exploring new parameter space. Because old parameter space, many people have done the experiment, so chances of a new discovery is not there. So you get a serendipity only if you have an experiment which is new. And that was the nature of the Huish et al. Experiment, because that was the first time you were looking at the output of a radio telescope with 100 millisecond time resolution. Usually people used to integrate for minutes and hours. So one data point in an hour, but their experiment required 100 millisecond data taking. So that was a new parameter space, and hence this was possible, because the period of the pulsar is 1 second. So if you are integrating over 60 seconds, you won't see the pulse at all. And then you needed a certain strategy of observation. They were doing what was a repeated monitoring of different parts of the sky again and again every day for the whole year. Such observations are known as survey observations. Okay. So the nature of the experiment was survey, not pointing to a particular star and looking at that. And that is what played an important role in the serendipity. the scientific arguments are also important, and that is where the hypothesis or model building and then validation of this hypothesis based on the facts known to you is important. And towards the later part of the sort of description of the discovery of pulsars, I highlighted the kind of arguments which were used. So you need both of these to be able to understand some new phenomena. So this is something which you people should keep in mind, nothing to do with pulsars, but this is true in general. So let's now quickly come to what are radio pulsars. So radio pulsars are basically produced when a star with a mass about 3 to 10 times the mass of the sun ends its lifetime. What I mean by ending its lifetime is throughout the lifetime of the star, there is a battle between the self-gravity of the star and the gas inside the star. Self-gravity compresses the gas pressure keeps sort of supporting the outer weight of the outer layer of the star. In this battle, the temperature at the interior of the star goes to 10 to the power 7 Kelvin and so on. It is large enough to allow hydrogen to fuse to helium and higher order nuclear reactions. And energy is released. So as long as this energy is released and the pressure of the radiation provides additional support to the star. So as long as this process goes on, the stars keep shining and you see it as a star. But the nuclear fuel at the center of the star is not infinite. And the fusion process can only proceed up to iron, because beyond iron, we have to actually supply energy to sort of do a fission process. Okay. So the reaction becomes endothermic post-iron. So when all the elements inside have been cooked up to iron, there is nothing to supply any more energy to the star, and that is the end of the lifetime of the star. Okay. So at that time, for stars with masses 3 times to 10 times the solar mass, what happens is that there is a catastrophic explosion and the entire star gets disrupted. The outer layers of the stars are thrown out and you are left with a very shiny, beautiful object like this, which is known as supernova remnant. On the other hand, the inner part of the star collapses, and it collapses, and that is mostly iron. Okay. So as it collapses, these iron nuclei break into neutrons, free neutrons, and you are left with a neutron star, and that is how the relic core or a neutron star is born. And radio pulsars are nothing but neutron stars.
Excuse me. What initiates the explosion?
There will be a point, a critical point, at which the nuclear reactions will not, because the initiation of nuclear reactions is dependent on temperature. And it's an exceedingly high power of temperature. It's one of the very strong functions. The nuclear reaction rates are proportional to T to the power 7. Okay. So any small fluctuation in the temperature can increase or decrease the nuclear reaction. Okay. So as the elements get cooked up to iron, there comes a point when the temperature falls below that critical temperature and no more nuclear reaction. Since the nuclear reactions are not there, there is no energy being produced. This energy is radiated by radiation. The radiation itself has pressure. Okay. So this pressure is switched off. And that leads to the outer layer of the stars to fall inside. Okay. If it is a star lesser than 2 times the mass of the sun, the required pressure to support can be provided by degenerated electron gas. And the star does not explode. It just fades away as a white dwarf. That is what the white dwarfs are. But if it is a much more massive star, then this process has to take place. So the collapse starts taking place, and then there is a shock wave. The inner core actually rebounds and it generates a shock wave, which burns the outer layer into a large explosion, which is what is seen as supernova explosion. For stars which are much more massive, nothing can prevent the collapse, and eventually they will collapse into a black hole, which I think Ranjeev is going to talk about on some other lecture. So how do we see pulses? Okay, so essentially what you see in a radio pulsar is radio emission in the form of a train of narrow pulses. And we have already seen that what we are seeing this emission because we are looking at the emission from a rapidly rotating neutron star. So they are like celestial lighthouses. The star is rotating like this. The magnetic axis of the star is misaligned with the rotation axis. And every so often, the beam of the star, the radio beam of the star, which is anchored to the magnetic force, crosses your line of sight and you see neutrons. This is a very simple sort of minded picture of how neutron stars produce radio. And this is just an example of radio pulses from two different strong pulsars observed using GMRT, B0740-28 and BOC29+54. Maybe if this pulsar is available on Saturdays in the afternoon, you will actually see the pulses being observed from GMRT. What I want you to notice in this plot is the remarkable periodicity of the pulses. The separation between the pulses is very, very constant. So pulsars have very highly stable periodicity. In other words, pulsars are very ideal celestial clocks. And this point you should keep in mind, because this is very important when you set up gravity experiments. Okay? It is this remarkable property of pulsars which is important for their being used in various gravity experiments. This is just another illustration of how stable the pulsar periods are. So this is just a plot where the stability of the pulsar period has been compared with the stability of an atomic clock. So pulsars are as good as terrestrial atomic clocks. And we are discovering more of these pulsars. And although the atomic clocks are becoming better, still they are comparable to that. So they are very accurate clocks. So why this period is so stable? What is the cause for the high stability of the pulsar period? So pulsars are neutron stars, and the fact that neutron stars would exist is not new. Just after Chandrasekhar proposed the electron degenerate gas model for white dwarfs, people thought if electrons are fermions, neutrons are also fermions. So if you can have a star called white dwarf made up of electrons, why can't we have a star made up of entirely of neutrons? So they tried to work out the full structure of this particular star. And although the star was never detected from 1930s to 1967, for 40 years, theoreticians did work out the full model of neutron stars. And they found that the rate of this star should be of the order of one and a half times the mass of the sun. They also estimated what should be its diameter, and they came to a number like 20 to 30 kilometers. Okay? It's much smaller than the city of Pune or Delhi or any of the metros, if the star is so small. So if you have such a large mass and such small volume, the density of the star would be extremely large. It would be of the order of nuclear density, 10 to the power 14 grams per cc and so on. And a sphere with such high density and such high mass will have an exceedingly large moment of inertia. The moment of inertia of a typical neutron star is of the order of 10 to the power 45. So since it has a large I, the rotational kinetic energy, suppose it was rotating with a period of 1, you can calculate the rotational kinetic energy, which is just half I omega square. Okay? That will be an exceedingly large number. So essentially, a radio pulsar or a neutron star represents a reservoir of large rotational kinetic energy. Now, if you want to slow down this by simple conservation of energy argument, you will need to extract some energy out of it. And to do that, you need extremely powerful brakes. So if you want to slow down the pulsar by a large amount, you need an extremely powerful sort of brake. And such brakes don't exist. So that is the basic reason why the pulsars cannot slow down very much, or their rotations cannot have very large irregularity. Just for comparison, I have given here the number for moment of inertia of Earth, which is almost 12 orders of magnitude less than a neutron star. So, since it's so much less than this, you have things like tides and other tidal effect of solar system bodies, which can actually slow down or exert an uneven torque on the rotation of the Earth. And the rotation of the Earth changes quite a lot. As we know, in the last two decades alone, there have been 7 leap seconds which have been added. Okay. So the amount of change in rotation, and it's not regular, it is quite irregular. So Earth is not a good clock, although we use it for all the time. But Earth is certainly not a good clock. This clock, by the same orders of magnitude, is much better than the Earth. And that is basically coming from the large moment of inertia of the neutron star. So the pulsar period is stable, or pulsars are good clocks because they have a large moment of inertia. When I say the period of the pulsar is stable, I don't mean it is constant. In fact, even for atomic clocks, the periods are not constant. But they have high stability. And by stability, what you mean is that the change in their frequency or in the period is highly predictable. So, like, in a similar analogy, the period of the pulsar actually increases as a function of time. Because the star loses energy. And why it loses energy? Because we see the radio pulses, we see various emissions. Okay. All that emission is being supplied by the rotational kinetic energy of the star. So it does lose that energy. So if we apply that principle of conservation of energy, the slowdown of the star is equal to the loss of energy. And then we can think of a mechanism of radiation where we can find out how much energy is radiated and equate that to the loss of the energy. So the simplest mechanism which one can think of is the electromagnetic dipole radiation. So it's just a magnet. So if you have a rotating magnet, it will produce electromagnetic radiation. And you can do simple electrodynamics. Some of you might have done it in Jackson. Okay? So you can work out what is the power radiated by a rotating dipole. So you can assume the neutron star to be a simple dipole and rotate it and find out how much power it is radiated. So you will get an expression for power. You can equate that power to the loss of rotational kinetic energy. And when you do that, I am not doing all that math here, when you do that you will find that you will have the expression for magnetic field in your power formula. So that magnetic field you can sort of express in terms of the period and the rate of change of period. So it's given by some constant into this particular. So the formula comes in a simplified form as this. Now remember, the period of the pulsar and the rate of change of the period of the pulsar is a measurable quantity. So in your chart record, you can find out the period today, and then you can keep on finding this period for next one year. Then you can find out that how much it has changed in 1 year. So both P and P dots are measurable. So once you know the P and P dot, you can estimate what would be the magnetic field of the neutron star. It so turns out that the magnetic field calculated in this particular fashion from this simple minded physical argument is of the order of 10 to the power 12 Gauss or 10 to the power 7 Tesla, which is a tremendously large magnetic field. Even on Sun, you don't have such large magnetic field. Most stars which we know of don't have such large magnetic field. So pulsars are highly magnetized neutrons. And this is a very common method of finding out the magnetic field of it. It's an indirect method, not a direct method, but you can get an estimate of the magnetic field in this particular fashion. So how many pulsars we know today? They are not very big. Unlike billions and billions of stars which we know, there are only 2,200 pulsars discovered today. And most of them are in our own galaxy. There are few which are in a satellite galaxy, but there are no extragalactic pulsars which have been discovered. And usually you can represent all the discovered pulsar samples in a diagram like this, where the x-axis is period, the y-axis is the rate of change of period, or p dot. So this diagram is called as p dot diagram. So for every pulsar, you can measure the period and period derivative. And in the previous slide, I also pointed out that period-period derivation will give you an estimate of the magnetic field. So in some sense, you have an estimate of magnetic field, which is indicated by these dash dot lines on the p-dot diagram. So this is a sort of a sample of about 1800 pulsars on this p-dot diagram. And you can clearly see that there are three different clusters of these pulsars. So you can classify the known pulsars as of today in three different groups. This is the largest cluster is what is known as normal pulsars. And they have a magnetic field of the order of 10 to the power 11 to 10 to the power 12 Gauss. There is a small cluster here which was discovered in 90s, which is known as millisecond pulsars, because if you see, all their periods are of the order of milliseconds. But the important thing there is that this magnetic field lines here would indicate that their magnetic fields are of the order of 10 to the power 9. So they are having much weaker magnetic field as compared to the normal pulsars. In the last decade, in the last 11 years or so, a new class of objects has emerged here, okay, which has magnetic fields in excess of 10 to the power 14 Gauss. So since they are super strong magnetic field neutron stars, they are called as magnetons. So right now there are these three different classes of stars. Now majority of these stars are solitary neutron stars, but there are quite a few of these which have been discovered which have a companion, and the companion can range from white dwarf to a main sequence star to another neutron star. These are known as binary pulsars. In the last 3 to 4 years, a new classification has started coming up thanks to a high energy satellite which went up 2 to 3 years back called Fermi Lab. It has a large area telescope for gamma ray astronomy, and it has found a large number of pulsars which have never been seen in radio. Remember, neutron stars traditionally were discovered by radio waves. So till the beginning of the century, most of the neutron stars were radio pulsars. It's only towards the end of last century, X-ray and high energy equipment went up, and they started discovering neutron stars for which there were no radio components. When the Fermi has gone up, it has found many more neutron stars, and a large majority of these neutron stars do not have radio counterparts. So a new classification is emerging in the last 3 years, which is radio loud versus radio quiet Fermi pulsars. Okay. So this is just to sort of give you an idea of the diversity of the population which is there. Just to sort of, again, none of this you need to remember other than the three classes which I have told you, and certainly I don't expect you to remember any of these, but this is just giving you the kind of diversity which is there in the population of neutron stars. So the first pulsar which Jocelyn Bell discovered was 1919 plus 21, which was 1.3 seconds. Okay. The fastest pulsar known today is 1748 minus 2446, which is just about a millisecond. So the period of the pulsar is just a millisecond. It's a very fast rotator. So remember, a 10 kilometer diameter star rotating is almost 741 hertz. Okay, so it is rotating 741 times per second. The slowest pulsar known today is 8.5 seconds. Actually, the magnetars do not have radio counterparts, but if you include magnetars, the slowest known pulsars would be 17 seconds. Okay. The first binary pulsar which was discovered was 1913 plus 18, and we'll come back to this pulsar at a later point of time. The first extra solar planets which were discovered around the pulsar, 1257 plus 12. And there's only one system which has two neutron stars going around each other, both of them seen as a radio pulsar. That is known as double pulsar. There's only one system to date. Again, we'll come back to this at a later point of time. So we have about 2,200. The population models tell us that in the galaxy there should be more than a million neutron stars. So there are a large number of neutron stars which are yet to be discovered, or radio pulsars yet to be discovered. The highest magnetic field is of the order of 10 to the power 15 Gauss. The lowest is 10 to the power 7 Gauss. The most massive of these stars, I told you that the neutron star mass is of the order of 1.5 times the mass of the Sun. But that is not strictly speaking true. The lowest mass is about 1.2 times the mass of the Sun. And the most massive star, which was just discovered 2 years back, is twice the mass of the Sun. So it's just telling you the large variety of properties which the pulsar has. And that is very important. This large diversity of properties allows you to set up diverse astrophysical experiments. Because astronomy is not a controlled experiment. Astronomy is an observational science. You can only observe. So you do an astronomical experiment by finding the right type of object which will either prove or disprove the hypothesis which you are trying to sort of prove or disprove. So to find the right type of object, you need a diversity of objects. And pulsars do provide that kind of diversity. So all I want you to take from this lecture, okay, since we are almost at 45 minutes, is summarized in this particular transparent. So even if you remember this much, my job is done. That radio pulsars are neutron stars which are highly magnetized and which rotate. The radio pulsation is because of rotation. And what you see as radio emission is a train of narrow pulses. And they have highly stable periods. So the most important property is the high stability of the period. The range of periods is from 1.5 milliseconds to 8.5, or as I said, 16 seconds. The pulsar period is very stable. It increases, but it increases with a very tiny amount, 1 part in 10 to the power 3. And these are, being neutron stars, they are very compact stars. They have a diameter of the order of between 9 to 12 kilometers. A density which is almost nuclear density at the center of the star, and a very large moment of inertia. They have very large magnetic fields. And since it's a magnetic, rotating magnet, it produces an electric field. So it also has very large electric fields. Near the poles, the electric fields could be 10 to the power 12 electron volts. So if you have an electron in that electric field, it will be accelerated extremely close to the speed of light. So you have Lorentz factors of 1 million or 1 billion to in this kind of field which is generated. So all this brings home this basic point that it is a star of extremes. And the value of radio pulsars for physics or for astrophysics is precisely because of this property. Since there are all kinds of extremes which are happening in this star, you can set up exotic experiments to test exotic physics, which you can never do on a terrestrial planet. So that comes from the extremity of properties of these stars. Okay, so now I will, the remaining 15-20 minutes, I will just talk about what kind of research is done using these radio pulsars. I will not be going into the detail because I don't want to bore you people with all the different type of research which has been done in the last 40 years and what is important and what is not important. So I just put down a list here. Okay? So you could study the pulsar for pulsar's own sake. You could try to understand what produces the radio pulsar. Nowadays we see pulsars or neutron stars in X-ray and high energy also. So you could also try and find out what produces pulsation at those energies. Is it thermal radiation, as Rajaram mentioned? Is it a black body radiation or is it a non-thermal radiation? What are the physical processes which happen in the exterior of the neutron star which produces the radiation which you see? Okay? And that has important implications for plasma physics, because most of this radiation is produced by highly relativistic plasma, electron positron plasma. So by studying the emission from these 2200 pulsars, you can try and set up experiments where you can study the plasma physics. You can use pulsars as tools, because Nimisha talked yesterday about ISM. So we have, in the interstellar medium, we have structures of electron in homogeneity. How they are distributed in the galaxy, you can study, because pulsars are distributed all over the galaxy. And since the signal is pulse signal, it gets dispersed by the electrons in between you and the pulsar. And that dispersion and the scattering, which is done by these of the radiation of the pulsar done by these electrons, allows you to study these inhomogeneities. So it can be used as a tool to study ice. It can be used as a tool to study the internal structure of the neutron star. Because we are talking of extreme densities, 10 to the power 14 grams per cc, the matter in the core of the star is not normal matter. So you can set up experiments where you could try and constrain the standard model of particle physics. So because at those densities, you will just not have neutrons, protons and electrons. Each of these fundamental particles will break into quarks. So there are different types of scenario of what makes up the core of the neutron star. And depending on that, the diameter of the star as well as the mass of the star is determined, and the structure of the star. So you could use your different models to try and give two observables, the radius and the mass of the star, and with that constraint some of these theories. You can use pulsars as a tool. As I said, many of these are in binary systems, so the theory of evolution of binaries can be studied using pulsars as a tool. Pulsars give you a very accurate clock, but this clock will not be constant because it is going in a binary system. The clock will not be constant because the pulsar is going around its companion. So as it goes around its companion, its relative velocity with you as an observer is going to change. And as the relative velocity changes, it will introduce a Doppler shift in the clock frequency which you are measuring here. So by measuring that clock frequency, the Doppler shift in the clock frequency, you can actually reconstruct the orbit of the binary to a large extent. And that allows you to study the binary. Last but not the least, pulsars can be used as tools to set up a laboratory for testing gravity theories. And this is the point which I will spend a little bit more time. So I will not explain the details of the other things, but I will more or less concentrate on this last point. And to do all this, you need to have a large variety of pulsars available. As I said, 2,200 have been discovered, but there are 1 million yet to be discovered. And some of them may be very exotic or interesting systems. So you need to search for new pulsars to be able to do that. So one of the major things which all pulsar astronomers do is to launch into large surveys right from the first day of the pulsar astronomy to look for new pulsars. Remember, 2,200 is a very tiny fraction of the number of stars we know. So we still need to know many more of these stars. Okay, so what I will do is that in the next 10 or 15 minutes, very quickly, okay, again, I'll not go into the details, although on the transparencies there will be many more details. But what I urge you is, I will only highlight few of the points. If any of you are interested, you can come and later discuss with me about the other things. Okay? So, before I do that, let me very briefly touch upon relative gravity in a nutshell kind of thing. Okay? So, Einstein proposes two theories of relativity, the special theory of relativity and the general theory of relativity, on two basic principles. The special theory of relativity relies on the constancy of speed of light. So the entire structure of special theory of relativity was built on the fact that the speed of light is constant and it is the maximum, it is the speed limit of the universe. The general theory of relativity was based on what is also known as Mach's equivalence principle. So in a normal, say, in an electromagnetic field, the force on a particular particle defines the acceleration on that particle, okay, but the force is produced by the charge. That is not true for gravitation. In gravitation, the source and what produces acceleration and what gets accelerated is the same thing. It is the same mass which produces acceleration and it is the same mass which gets accelerated. So there is an equivalence between the inertial mass and the source mass, and that was the basic foundation of Mach's principle of equivalence, and the entire structure of general theory of relativity is built on that. Now, most of you have not done relativity, so don't bother if you don't understand some of those things. What these two principles imply is that, first of all, space and time is not independent, and if you have two inertial frames means frames which are not accelerated, which are moving with constant velocity with respect to each other, they are related by an expression called Lorentz transform. And laws of physics are invariant between both these frames. So if you do an experiment to test the law of physics in one frame, you can relate the results of that experiment in the other frame by a transformation which is known as Lorentz transform. Okay. Now, because of the speed limit of light, this essentially meshes the space and time together, which has very interesting sort of connotations, which I will not go into that. So that was special theory of relativity. But this was valid only in inertial frame, in non-accelerated frame. Einstein was worried that what do I do if there are no non-accelerated frames? And as it happens, in the universe there are no non-accelerated frames, except what is known as a freely falling body, a freely falling frame. Because when we are standing on Earth, we are accelerated. We are accelerated by the acceleration of gravity. So most of our laws of physics we actually measure on a lab, which is an accelerated frame. Okay. So there does not exist a preferred frame, or a preferred frame like inertial frame or a non-accelerated frame. And that follows from equivalence principle. So he wanted to sort of come at a description of laws of physics in an accelerated frame and relate it between two accelerated frames. Because most of the physics which we do is being done in accelerated frames. And that was the motivation for general theory of relativity. And when he applied those principles, he found that he cannot use Euclidean geometry. Now, the Cartesian coordinate system, which I discussed the other day, is an example of a Euclidean geometry. Okay. So he needed a different coordinate system to be able to describe all that. And for that, he borrowed the Riemannian geometry to get a description of that. And he found that when he does this in a mathematical framework, the net implication of that is that gravitating masses produce curvature in the space-time. And you can describe everything in terms of a space-time metric, where a curvature will denote a mass. And not only mass, any form of energy will also lead to curvature. So we can forget about these things other than the fact that it produces curvature. A very schematic way of showing it is there in this particular figure, where you have the earth and it is producing a curvature. The amount of curvature it produces in the space depends on the amount of mass which the body has. So the more massive, more compact the body is, the more would be the curvature. Earth is not very compact, Earth is not very massive. So these effects will be very, very small for us, and that is why they are not all the time visible. But a neutron star, remember, is 10 kilometer diameter and 1.5 times the mass of the Sun. Extremely compact object. So the general theory of relativistic effects will be much, much larger for a neutron star. So this is essentially coming from the theories of relativity which Einstein proposed. Now before I proceed, I should also mention that the Einstein's theory of relativity is not the only theory of relativity. Because Einstein started from equivalence principle and came to a particular theory of relativity, which is known as general theory of relativity. But there were other physicists who started from the same equivalence principle, but violated some of the things which Einstein took for granted, and they came up with alternative theories of relativity. So there are about 10 to 15 different theories of relativity, which all compete with the Einstein's theory of relativity. Now all of these, their effects will be different when the mass becomes very large. So as far as the Earth or solar system is concerned, generally all of them agree. Okay? So there is no difference between them. So if you want to distinguish between them, you have to go to a very, very compact object. And that is where the neutron stars or radio pulsars play a very important role. So the consequences of this general theory of relativity, again I'm not going to the details, is that first of all, the orbit of a test particle around the mass is not a closed orbit. Okay? Now some of you might have done statistical mechanics. How many of you have done statistical mechanics? Okay. So there are a few of them, but not all of you. So in it's a central force problem in statistical mechanics language. And Newtonian gravity, the central force is 1 by r square. For this, there is a vector called Runge-Lenz vector, which is conserved. And the conservation of this essentially tells you that you have only 1 degree of freedom in the orbit, which means that the orbits are closed. Okay. So those of you who have not done statistical mechanics, forget about all what I talked just now. That's only for the people who know a little bit about classical mechanics. Okay, classical mechanics, not stat mechanics. So all you have to remember, the rest of the people, is that for Newtonian gravity, the orbits will be closed. If there are no other perturbations, there is a central body gravitating mass, any orbit of a test particle is closed. Now that's not true in general theory of relativity, because the central force is not of this form, it is of a different form. That means that the orbits are not closed. Okay? So instead of a 1 degree freedom orbit, you have a 2 degree freedom orbit, because this vector is not conserved. Which means that the orbit is in a plane, but it is never closed. So it makes a curve like this. Okay. Whereas the closed orbit would be just something like this. Now if you have a binary system which is very eccentric orbit, okay, some orbit like this, where this point, which is the separation between the two bodies which make the binary, okay, which is known as periastron in astronomy. So if you have a binary system like this, because of general theory of relativity, this periastron will not remain same because the orbit will precess, so which means this periastron will shift. And this is known as advance of periastron. Now neutron stars are highly compact stars, and the usual general theory of relativistic effects are much, much larger. This, by the way, happens for the solar system also, but it is very, very tiny. But in a neutron star binary, both the objects are highly compact objects, so these effects are much larger. So if you can compute the orbit of one neutron star around another neutron star, and if it is eccentric orbit, you will find that the periastron will advance in that. So you could set up an experiment to find out how much the periastron is advancing and compare it with the theory of relativity and see whether it is consistent with the theory of relativity. So that is one kind of experiment you can do. The other kind of experiment depends on what is known as gravitational redshift, which is the change of frequency of a photon which it moves in a gravity field. Again, I'll not go into the details, except for saying that this was the first true test of GTR. Okay? The Eddington's experiment was not a true test of GTR. The first real test of GTR was in 1950 in this experiment called bound replica, where they sent a photon in a tower up and noticed the direction in that. So basically, the frequency of a photon reduces in gravitational field. That's why the redshift. And that is also something which you can measure and you can do it. Now, how can we measure this particular thing? We can actually measure this because we have a clock, which is the pulsar. So the clock will also undergo a redshift in a strong gravity regime. And you can measure the gravitational redshift of the clock. There is a third effect, which was not discovered by Einstein, but by a scientist known as Shapiro. When you have electromagnetic radiation passing in the vicinity of the curved space-time, the photon will follow what is known as null geodesics, and the time of flight of photon will become larger. Or in other words, the photon gets retarded. So this retardation leads to a delay in arrival. When you use radio pulsars, it's very easy to measure these delays because your pulse should have come at a particular point of time, but it comes at a much later time. When I say much later, it is not larger than few nanoseconds, but it is later than the normal time. And you can measure it very accurately because these are accurate clocks. So this is known as Shapiro. And finally, the one thing which distinguishes the general theory of relativity from Newtonian gravity is the gravitational waves. Newton assumed action at a distance which is instantaneous. The difference in Einstein's self-consistent general theory of relativity is that everything is limited by speed of light. That naturally produces gravitational waves when you have two masses going in. So there will be gravitational waves. Now, gravitational waves will carry energy. So the source is your binary system where two neutron stars are going around each other. That is the source of the gravity wave. But gravity waves will carry energy from this. So if you apply the principle of conservation of energy, it would mean that the binary system will lose energy. And when a binary system loses energy, its orbit will shrink. So if there are gravitational waves, you can try and look for a shrinking of orbit and from that infer that there is a gravity wave emitted by it. So these are all the things which you can do. The last thing which I will very briefly mention is these gravity waves will propagate in the space-time where there is no neutron star, there is no star. The metric will get perturbed. Normally it is a flat metric, which means the normal space which we are talking about. But because of the gravity waves which carry energy, and remember in general theory of relativity, energy also curves space. Okay? So this periodic energy which is passing by will introduce perturbation in the metric, which will retard or advance the time of the pulse which is traveling through this empty space. And will leave an imprint on the pulsar signal. So you could use that to see traveling gravity waves also. So all these things, all these concepts have been applied. And I will very quickly go through what is there because I am almost out of time. So basically, pulsars, as I mentioned earlier, pulsars are ideal clocks. Okay? And clocks have played enormous significant role in understanding relativity. So what better tool we have to set up an experiment than pulsars? And the first indication of this came in 1975 when these two gentlemen, Joseph Taylor and Hulse, discovered the first system with two neutron stars, which was a double neutron star system, V1913+16. And they discovered this in a pulsar survey being carried out using Arecibo telescope, which I showed earlier. And after some amount of similar scientific arguments, like the arguments I sort of mentioned for the discovery of the first pulsar, they came to the conclusion that what they are seeing are two neutron stars which are gravitationally bound to each other. But they saw pulses only from one neutron star. So only one of them was a pulsar, radio pulsar. The other one could not be seen in radio. But they inferred from some scientific argument, which I am not going to, that both of them were neutron stars. Now both of these are compact, highly dense objects. So obviously, from the previous description which I gave, they will have relativistic effects. So such binaries are known as relativistic effects. Okay. Then they made further measurements and they found that the apparent period meaning the period which you have measured at the observatory, changes because of the Doppler shift of the pulsar going around the other neutron star. And from the Doppler shift, when they measured this Doppler shift over several days, they found that this Doppler shift is periodic. By finding that period, they could get the orbital period of the binary system. Once you get the orbital period, you can use the Kepler's law to find out the full trajectory of the orbit as well as the masses of the two neutron stars. So they did that and they got the full orbit of the star and they got the mass of the star. And they also measured the gravitational redshift of the star. And finally, which has gone somewhere here, they also measured the advance of periastron of this particular star. So basically, they got the advance of periastron, they got the gravitational redshift, the two general relativistic effects which I talked about. Then from 75 onwards, they kept on timing this block, this pulsar block. And in 82, finally, they found that this orbital period which they are measuring is not constant, it is changing. And it is changing by exactly the amount which is predicted by general theory of relativity if gravitational waves do exist, or if this system is generating gravitational waves. So that was a very landmark discovery, because this was the first time the existence of gravitational waves, although in an indirect fashion, was demonstrated. And they were, of course, awarded a Nobel Prize for this discovery. So there was a third name associated there, which is not there in the discovery paper or in the Nobel Prize, but who has done most of the work in the last 30 years, and that his name is Joel Weisfeld. Okay. This system is being observed from 1975 till date. Okay, so it's about 40 years of timing this pulsar clock. And this is a 2010 sort of plot from Hulse, David Nice and Weisberg, Taylor, David Nice and Weisberg, which shows you the prediction of the general theory of relativity if gravitational waves are being emitted by the system, which is the solid line. And all the dots there are the measurements which these people have made using B1930+60. And you can see that they agree perfectly there. Okay. It's a very sure shot proof of the existence of gravitational waves. So one of the significant aspects of this discovery was to show that gravitational waves do exist. The other significant part was, I mentioned that there are many alternative theories of gravity. This system ruled out all but three or four alternative theories of gravity. So many gravity theories were totally constrained by this particular system. It gave you a 10% or about 5% confidence on the Einstein's theory of relativity, general theory of relativity. 5% because the error bars on this system were still fairly large. But in 2003, we discovered another system which is called as double pulsar, J0737-3039. This pulsar was just like the Hulse-Taylor pulsar, except for two or three important differences. First of all, we could see both the neutron stars as radio pulsars. One of the neutron stars had a period of 23 milliseconds and the other one had a period of 2.7 seconds. Okay. So we could measure the periods of both the stars, which makes life much more simpler when you do these gravity experiments. In addition, unlike the Hulse-Taylor pulsar, which was inclined, which was at an inclination as far as you are concerned, this was an edge-on pulsar. So to detect the Shapiro delay in the 1930s plus 60 was not possible. Since this is an edge-on pulsar, the signal from the pulsar behind the pulsar in front travels through the gravitational, the strong gravity of this neutron star and gets significantly retarded. Okay. And in fact, you can see that retardation here. So this is x-axis is the orbit of the pulsar, which is just about 2.5 hours. So in this lecture, the pulsar has gone almost 180 degrees. Okay. So that is the orbit of the pulsar. And this is after removing all the different model parameters, but leaving the Shapiro delay there. So you see when the pulsar is near the next pulsar, there is an extra delay, which is of the right shape as predicted by Shapiro, which you see there. Okay. So you have additional constraints in this system, and the system has provided one of the most accurate measurements of the masses of the neutron star. Okay. This is slightly old.